in the fireplace room with a black leather chair. I am moving to the computer, CD-ROM, scanner, and printer. A glass coffee table. A black sofa. And a red Persian rug. I'm now in the master bedroom where you see a TV VCR.
Tonight we are celebrating 500 years of Sephardic Jewish heritage and culture with the Dardashti family in concert. I'm very excited about their performance this evening. Farid and I have been planning this concert for a long time, and I know that you will enjoy him and his beautiful family. Farid Dardashti holds the distinction of being the first Persian singer and chazan in the Western world. He has appeared on television, concert, and opera stages throughout the world, and as a teenager starred in his own weekly television program in his native land. His musical education moved to the West, where he studied at Wesley College and Mann's Conservatory of Music in New York. He graduated as Chazan from the Seminary College of Jewish Music, and is presently Chazan of Chizuk Amunah Congregation in Baltimore, Maryland. Chazan Farid Dardashti and his talented family, wife Sheila and daughters Danielle, Galit, and Michelle, lead the way to where East meets West in song. Sheila is a graduate of the famed High School of Performing Arts in Manhattan and Queens College. She's presently a teacher of special education and has just received her Master of Science degree from Johns Hopkins University. Danielle is a graduate of the University of Maryland, and Galit is presently a student there. And Michelle attends high school in Pikesville, Maryland. The Dardashti sing in 12 languages, accompany themselves on guitar, mandolins, and percussion instruments. Their melodies and messages, dramatically interpreted, embody the dreams and hopes of all of us. Their energy generated on stage as a family appeals to the universal human desire for love and commitment. Individually, the Dardashtis are great. Together, they form the quintessential quintet. There are many people to thank and acknowledge for the success of an evening like this. We have tried to include many names in our program. We could not have done it without you. We really appreciate all of your support. People not mentioned in our program include Lance Coley and our Vinay Shuren staff. A thank you to them, and a special thank you to my secretary, Karen Glick, and to Bernice Rothman for their hours and hours of loving dedication and tireless efforts. A yasher koach and thank you to our rabbis, Stanley Schachter and David Seed, for always providing us with inspired guidance. No one worked harder than the two gentlemen that I'm about to introduce. I have asked both co-chairmen Ike Yedid and Isaac Yomtovian to say just a few words to orient us a little more with their Sephardic heritage. Ike Yedid, where are you?
I'm grateful to see all of you here this evening. You are a testimony to the vibrant cultural and religious community we have here in Cleveland. Tonight's concert, as you've heard, will celebrate Sephardic music and heritage as we remember the 500th anniversary of the expulsion of the Jews from Spain at the hands of Queen Isabella and King Ferdinand. Some of you may ask, what does the word Sephardic mean? Who are the Sephardic people? We know they comprise a substantial portion of Israeli and rural Jewry, and we know that their numbers are much smaller in comparison here in the United States. The name Sephardic comes from the Bible, where it mentions a region called Sepharad. Today in modern Hebrew, we call it Spain. After the destruction of the Second Temple some 2,000 years ago, the Jews fled the Holy Land. Some went north to Babylonia, now known as Persia. Others went to Spain. They lived under Christian and Muslim rule. Jewish culture flourished under Muslim rule. By the 10th century, Spain became the center of Jewish learning throughout the world under the great sage Maimonides. Jews were respected as teachers, physicians, businessmen, members of the royal court. This golden age of Jewry came to an end, a violent end, in the 15th century during the Crusades, when the Christian armies drove the Muslims from Spain. In 1492, on the day of Tish B'Av, the very day when Jews even today mourn the destruction of the two great temples, the Spanish monarchy's edict forced 300,000 Jews to flee Spain. It is ironic that the same day when one haven for Jewry was closed, Christopher Columbus set sail for the New World, eventually to discover another homeland for the Jewish people. Spanish Jews then emigrated in two major directions. One to Europe, and two to the Ottoman Empire, to Syria, to Greece, to Turkey, and to Morocco, among others. For the next 400 years, Sephardic Jews lived a relatively peaceful and fruitful existence under Muslim rule. They shared fully in the life and language and culture of their host country. In contrast, the Ashkenazi Jews in Poland and Russia at that time suffered savage persecution and pogroms. Their settlements were islands of safety within hostile native cultures. The Sephardic and Ashkenazic branches had very little contact in those times. There was no TV, no faxes, no telephones, no CNN. Travel was difficult. The two Jewish cultures didn't really meet until the early 20th century, when large numbers of Sephardic Jews emigrated to the United States to seek better economic opportunity. They met their Ashkenazi brethren already here. Plus, there was a strong pull of Zionism, where they united to achieve a common goal of an Israeli homeland. In summary, the differences between Ashkenazi and Sephardic Jews are those of external customs and traditions reflected in the cultures of where they lived. There was really no conflict of inner feelings. We worship the same God, we revere the same Torah, we celebrate the same holy days, if with slightly different Hebrew pronunciations and melodies. My family are Sephardic Jews of Syrian ancestry. We originally came from a close-knit community in Brooklyn, New York, of some 30,000 Syrians, whose ties remain very strong because they worship together, they live together, they send their children to the same day schools. Yet we feel comfortable and welcome in this fine Ashkenazi congregation, because above all else, we feel we are fellow Jews. I hope this brief historical perspective will help you enjoy better some of the fine Sephardic melodies which have evolved over the centuries. Thank you very much. I'd like to introduce my co-chairman for tonight, Isaac Yomtovian, who has a few words for you.
We all have a few words, but it will take longer than that. Orchim hayekarim, bruchim habayim. دوستان عزیز، تمام دوستان ایرانی خیلی خوش آمدید. امیدواریم که این برنامه دردشتی مورد توجه شما قرار بگیره و به زودی در آینده خیلی نزدیک دردشتی خانواده دردشتی دو مرتبه دعوت بکنیم برای برنامه ایرانی خودمون. This tonight is going to be an international night. So I just welcomed our very good Iranian friends here that have joined us to listen to the beautiful music of Dardashtis. Now, let me tell you how we got involved in this program. B'nai Jeshurun decided several months ago to put together a Sephardic program. So they looked around to find some Sephardic Jews. They found two Isaacs. Isaac Yadid from Syria and Isaac Yom Tovian from Iran, thinking that we are true Sephardics. Well, I went to New York to the Jewish Museum where we borrowed that beautiful exhibit there and met with a Sephardic rabbi in, I think it's called Midtown Manhattan, the Sephardic synagogue there. He gave me 1 hour of beautiful lesson about Sephardic Jewish people, and he told me, you are not a Sephardic. And you know what? This was not the first time that my identity became modified and somewhat changed. Because, you know, in Iran it was very simple. I knew that I was Jewish. But when I went to Israel in 66, I was told that I am Parsi, a Persian Jew. Then when I came to the United States, they told me, no, you are a conservative Sephardic Jewish. And now I find out that I am a conservative Sephardic Jewish from the Eidot HaMizrach, the communities of East. Now let me tell you a little bit about Iran. Cyrus the Great, Quraysh Kabir, the king of Iran, in the year 538 BC, over 2,500 years ago, captured Babylonia, today we call it Iraq, and he freed the enslaved Jews that they were in Babylonia. And that's how the ancestry of the Persian Jews started. You know about Purim, Esther and Mordechai. They were Parsim, the Jewish Persians. There are 4 books that documents the life of Persian Jews in Iran. Book of Esther, Ezra, Nehemiah, and one more that I forgot. But it's there, I assure you.
Daniel,
thank you. The Jews of Iran lived in Iran for over 2,500 years. During the kingdom of Nader Shah Afshar, King Nader, they obtained the freedom to practice religion in Mashhad. And that's where the strong religious community was developed in Mashhad in 18th century. But let me tell you another item, that the Babylonian Jews and the Iranian Jews were the ones that were leading the education and culture of the rest of the Jews in the world, including the Sephardic Jews of Spain in the early years. And the Sephardic Jews of Spain were borrowing the traditions and educations and the way of practicing Judaism from the Babylonian and Parsim, Persian Jews. Anyway, then we have the years of the Pahlavi dynasty. That was Reza Shah and Muhammad Reza Shah. Those days, we call it golden years of Jews of Iran. Beautiful cultural flourishment. And a product of that freedom of culture is tonight we will see. Ruhollah Dardashti, the father of Farid Dardashti, is a legend. He's still alive, thank God. His heavenly voice was all over Iran. Millions listened to his voice singing Farsi, beautiful Persian music. On Friday afternoons, those Iranians that are here and my age, you remember at 1:30 in the afternoon, we will turn on the Radio Tehran and Golhaye Javidan, for everlasting flowers. And we would listen to Dardashti. Dardashti has four sons and a daughter. Three of the sons are Khazanim and musicians, including Farid. The fourth one, it was not his fault. He went to Technion where I went and he became an engineer. The same year I became engineer. Farid is going to provide us an international program tonight, multicultural program, and the daughters. I would like to invite you all to welcome the Dardashti family. Please welcome them.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Michelle, and you'll be meeting the rest of the Dardashti family in just a few minutes. But right now, I'd like to introduce to you my father, Khazan Farid Dardashti.
Thank you and good evening, everyone. It's a pleasure being here in, where are we?
Cleveland.
Just wanted to know if you were awake. I would like to tell you that the first song that I sang, obviously you know it was in Persian, right? Wrong. What language was it? Was it? Okay. It was in Hebrew. I figured, you know, since all the Jews started from the land of Israel, we'll start the program with a song talking about how beautiful the nights are in the land of Canaan, which is the ancient name for the land of Israel. And those of you who have been to Israel, you know what a beautiful country it is. And the song says, even the stillness of the night sings to you and makes your heart want to sing songs. And the second song, I decided to sing a song with in Persian, so that I show my two backgrounds. As you know, in Iran, many, many years ago, we had a movie industry, which I don't believe it's we have anymore. But I remember there was an old Persian movie, and there was a song that I liked very much, and I sang for many, many years. It was the theme song from this particular movie. I don't even remember the movie's name, but the song itself, it stayed with me because, you know, the music is my thing. And I always sang it as a Persian dramatic love song, until I heard Luciano Pavarotti sing it in Italian. Then, first I thought he had borrowed it from Persian, and then I realized it's a Neapolitan song, so I'll sing it to you, see if you can guess what song it is.
Thank you very much, everyone. And now, ladies and gentlemen, my family! Yay! Happiness runs in a circular motion. Love is like a river but upon the sea. Everybody is a part of everything anyway. You can have it all if you let yourself be. Happiness runs, happiness runs.
In a meadow.
Our songs, which live on for future generations.
So how do you like my family? We are talking about Sephardic music, and you have heard already a lot about it. I'm not going to tell you anything about it, other than I'm going to sing a song from this beautiful heritage. It's called Scalerica di Oro, means the staircase of gold. And it's a wedding song, and it's about a bride that has no dowry. Arus jaws nadare. Now, in the United States, they say, well, big deal if the bride doesn't have her dowry, so she has her doctorate. But in the old days, we remember even in Iran in the old days, or in the Orient, and amongst the Jewish people in Spain, a bride without a dowry was very, very difficult to marry off. And one of the greatest good deeds was to be able to provide the dowry for the bride. So, but this particular song has a little bit of humor with it. It just says, La novia no tiene dinero. The bride has no money. Now, if she doesn't have any money, what does she have? What does she need? Mazal bueno. Good luck. Song is another Ladino song Quando il re Nimrod, quando decided to wait a couple of songs, a little bit later, he gave up his place to another Persian song, which I'm going to be singing, I was going to be singing in the second half, so I'm going to sing it in this half. It's the title song of my album, which I forgot to bring with me, so we can't buy it tonight if you want to. About a year, I said to myself, I am sure they're going to be, even though they want me to do international, but they're going to ask me to sing Persian songs, and I didn't want to sing some of the old songs. I think it's going to be something new. So one day I sat down to write a Persian song. The melody came in very quickly, but I was stuck with the words. I looked up some books of poetry and stuff like that. I wasn't satisfied. So one day my wife said, why don't you write it about me? That was the magic word. So I wrote it about her. And as you hear in the song, it says, if the whole world would blow away and not even a speck will be left of it, our love for each other will go on till the end of time. And says, do you remember? Now, I would like you to try to help me with this. Of course, the Persians know how to clap with this one, so they'll give you the rhythm. But the chorus will go like that. Lay, 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 lay I usually can't spot so many Iranians in my all of my audiences to be able to do this Persian snap. See if you all can try to do this. That's the music to my ear. But if you don't have any Persian blood in you, stick to this one. Or this one. Okay, let's go. La 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 la.
I still believe.
song was originally written by Shalom Secunda in Yiddish. It tells somehow about how a Jew celebrates different holidays. And his brother Sheldon wrote the English lyrics for it. And you know, Shalom Secunda is the composer of songs like By Me Bees to Shane and Dona Dona and songs like that. But he has written a lot of music for the synagogue and for concert repertoire. Wandering Jew.
Oh, Oh, It's just that I'm terrified.
banker, matchmaker, planning all plans. I'm in no rush, maybe I've learned, playing with matches a girl can get burned. So bring me no ring, groom me no groom, find me no fine, catch me no catch, unless he's a matchless match.
This next song is called The Evolution of a Melody, because I first wrote it as I was in a congregation in California. We had very, very upbeat services, and we clapped all throughout the services and sang. Every time we got to Adon Olam, somehow Adon Olam, it just didn't go with the clapping. Or some other ones. So I decided to write in Adon Olam that you couldn't sing without clapping. So this is the way this melody started, as an Adon Olam, and here's the way it goes.
And so on and so forth. This melody went on. And when I was making my Persian album, which was inspired by that first song, Yad El Miad, and I wanted to write a Persian wedding song, a new Persian wedding song, and I was trying to think of a melody, and my lyricist, Bijan Samandar, in Los Angeles, told me, he said, Farid, that Adon Olam melody is a perfect melody for a Persian wedding song. And he said, I've got the right lyrics for it. I said, okay, let me see how it goes. And this is the way that one went. خوشبخت باشن ایشالله از شاخه یاس بیچک دوان داره موشا برک همه بگید مبارک 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 عروسیتون مبارک and so on and so forth. The rest of it we can hear on the record someday. And then a friend of mine who listened to the melody said, you know, that's a beautiful song in English also. So he wrote this English lyrics for it, and it's called Life's a Song, and this is the way that one goes.
Listen very carefully, can you hear the melody? Come and join in harmony with your voice. Don't be long, the time is now to sing your song. Life's a song, a melody to be sung by you and me. Sometimes sad, sometimes carefree, we all must sing the song of life. Every man must listen his song to the world. Old or young, the voice he sings must be his own. Bad or good, right or wrong, the time is now to sing your song. That's a song, a melody, to be sung by you and me. Sometimes sad, sometimes carefree, we all must sing the song of life. La 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 la
decided to give Perchik permission to become engaged to our daughter, Huddle.
What? He's poor. He has nothing. Absolutely nothing.
He's a good man, Golda. I like him. Huddle likes him. Huddle loves him. What can we do? It's a new world. A new word. Love. Golda. Do you love me?
Do I what?
Do you love me?
Do I love you? When our daughter's getting married and there's trouble in the town, you're upset, you're worn out, go inside, go lie down. Maybe it's indigestion.
Golda, I'm asking you a question. Do you love me?
You're a fool.
I know, but do you love me?
Do I love you?
Well?
For 25 years I've washed your clothes, cooked your meals, cleaned your house, given you children, milked the cow. After 25 years, why talk about love right now?
Hold on. The first time I met you was on our wedding day. I was scared.
I was shy.
I was scared.
So was I.
But my father and my mother said we learned to love each other. And now I'm asking Golda, do you love me?
I'm your wife.
I know. But do you love me?
Do I love him?
No.
For 25 years I've lived with him, fought with him, starved with him. 25 years my bed is his. If that's not love, what is?
Then you love me.
I suppose I do.
I love you too. It doesn't change a thing, but even so, after 25 years.
Sheila, it's a special moment that we do this song on the stage together, but especially this year, because we truly are observing our 25th.
Oh boy.
sad, five children. Oh, yes, I have five children. Maybe six if the weather be good. Even if the weather be good.
Not even if the weather be good. Oh.
That was Michelle. Knows who Placido Domingo is, right? And everybody knows who John Denver is?
Yeah!
Very good. This is a very intelligent audience. But you're going to tell me, what has John Denver got to do with Placido Domingo? Well, believe it or not, John Denver wrote a song, and together with Placido Domingo, they recorded it. It's called Perhaps Love. Tonight, I am going to be John Denver. And Galita is going to be Placido Domingo. Perhaps love.
Perhaps love is like a resting place, a shelter from the storm. It exists to bring you comfort. It is there to keep you warm. And in those times of trouble, when you are most alone, the memory of love will bring you home.
Perhaps love is like a window, perhaps an open door. It invites you to come closer. It wants to show you more. And even if you lose yourself and don't know what to do, the memory of love will see you through. Oh, love to some is like a cloud, to some as strong as steel. For some way of living, for some way.
Some say love is holding on, and some say letting go, and some say love is everything. Some say they don't know. Perhaps love is like the ocean, full of conflict, full of pain, like a fire when it's cold outside. Thunder when it rains. If I should live forever and all my dreams come true, my memories of love will be of you.
Oh, love to some is like a cloud, to some as strong as steel. For some a way of living, for some a way to feel.
And some say love is holding on, and some say let it go, and some say love is everything. Some say they don't know. Perhaps love is like the ocean, full of conflict, full of pain, like a fire when it's cold outside. Thunder when it rains. If I should live forever and all my dreams come true, my memories of love will be.
Oh.
It says here in this book, the average unmarried female, basically insecure, due to some warm frustrations, may react with psychosomatic symptoms difficult to endure, affecting the upper respiratory tract. In other words, just from waiting around for that plain little band of gold, a place in a pocket develop a cold. You can spray her wherever you figure the streptococci loik. You can give her a shot for whatever she's got, but it just won't boink. If she's tired of getting the fisheye from the hotel cloak, a place in a pocket develop a cold. The female remaining single, just in the legal sense, shows a neurotic tendency. See, note. Note. Chronic organic syndromes, toxic or hypertense, involving the eye, the ear, the nose, and the throat. Whether the wedding is on or off, a poison can develop a cough. You can feed her all day with the vitamin A and the bromo fizz, but the medicine never gets anywhere near where the trouble is. If she's getting a kind of a name for herself and the name ain't his, a poison can develop a cold. And furthermore, just from stalling and stalling and stalling the wedding trip, a poison can develop la grip. When they get on the train for Niagara and she can hear the Hazen's voice so fine, the compartment was air conditioned and the mood sublime.